I'm Dominic, and this is Write Raw Policy Anywhere. In the previous video, I made a few mistakes that I'm going to correct in this, first of all. So, in the beginning of the video, I talked about that there is no way to really determine the use of type attributes that are assigned to existing types, except that we could use the names of the types to basically see if we can figure out what it is for, what kind of classification we're dealing with. So, for example, I was doing the SSH underscore T type, and I was, let's have a look, and I was saying, well, oops, SSH, I'm sorry, IRC T was it was. So I was basically saying, well, you can't really know what these attributes are, what these classifications are for, except that you get, you can basically read the name and then basically see what it's for. Now, that's not totally true, and it is important that you know the type attributes and the classifications, of course, because you cannot trust third parties, you cannot trust the people that designed these attributes. You should basically take matters in your own hands and verify stuff as much as possible. And so you can actually see what these classifications are for, at least for when it comes to type enforcement and role-based access control security models. You won't be able to, for example, figure out what the UBAC constraint type classification is for, because this security model uses policy constraints, which is a different mechanism than the type enforcement mechanism. And basically the system doesn't basically have a way for you to query a constraint, policy constraint rules, as far as I know. So, but for example, the application domain type, you could basically see what this classification is all about, and I showed you that in the end of my first video. But anyways, you could use the SE search command and then basically query the rules that are related to this type attribute. So let's see if this is and then when you say source application domain type, and then basically try to pipe that to that, see if that works. Yep, that works. So basically this is basically what it all allows. Now you can basically redefine that a bit by just grepping and then grep where the application domain type is a source and interaction. So or at least try domain type. Let's see what this gives us, and then pipe that to the last. Right, so here is basically, these are all the rules that are related, all the type enforcement allow access vectors that are related to the application domain type attribute. So basically, these are the rules that actually classify an application domain, at least it might not be all, but at least some, for example, all application domain types can basically get attribute and append to files with type admin home t. For example, application domain types, processes that are classified application domain type can read and write, get attribute, lock, append, IO control, files with type user cron spool t, and so on and so on. So, for example, this is, well, okay, so this is also weird. Any process with the classification of application domain type can basically append to any log file. So this is another classification. These are, if it doesn't end with the underscore t, then we're dealing with classification, aka type attributes. So basically, all log file types are assigned the log file attribute. At least that's an assumption, but you could verify that by basically using SEinfo to see, or SESearch, or yeah, use SEinfo to see what types have log file attribute assigned to them and stuff like that. We showed you that before, how to do that, and then basically use SESearch to see what stuff applies to it and all that. But anyway, so basically this, the assumption is that any process with the application domain type classification can write can append to any file with the log file classification. So that's basically pretty coarse grained. And this is another one. Basically, this is another classification, FD, this file descriptor, private file descriptor. Any process with classification of application domain type can basically use file descriptors of any, use any file descriptor with the prif FD classification. So this is basically what classifies, for a large extent, classifies the application domain type. There should be more, but see if there's more that I'm missing something. These are all the allowables. These are basically the rules that extend the type attribute. So these are all basically application domain types if you're looking at these. And there's a lot of rules here. A lot of them. Really a lot of them. So I'll just try to build it all the way down. There are a lot of application domain types on the system, obviously. Wow, truly many. Oh, and here we have some stuff. For example, Mozilla application domain type is allowed to execute anonymous memory for the process security classification of the target of type of Mozilla T when that boolean is set. So these are basically enabled, disabled, and here is the boolean that applies to it when it is enabled or disabled. Jeez, all these rules. And here you have these type transitions. But these are related to specific types and not to the application domain type attribute. But all these types here have the domain, the application domain type attribute assigned to them, but these rules do not apply to application domain types per se. So, poof, right. So basically, that's a way to verify all the rules related to classifying a classification. So that you know that when you classify your type with that classification with that type attribute, then you know, I'm allowing all these rules by default. And if you don't like that, what you could do is, for example, don't classify your type with this classification, with this type attribute, and just add manually the rules that you want and don't add the rules that you don't want. So for example, if you don't want to allow for example your application domain type to append to any log file, then just basically add all these rules to your module and then substitute your application domain type attribute here with your domain type. So for example, in this case it would be dependency_t, and add those rules except the rule where application domain types are allowed to append to log files, and then remove the application domain type attribute from your from your type. The problem is that stuff will break because changes might be made in the future too by the author of the original application domain type attribute to the application domain type attribute, and then they won't apply to your classification of application domain type, and then stuff might break. So it's not basically, if you don't agree with a particular rule that makes a classification, then you should basically file a bug upstream, because if it makes sense, then it should be fixed upstream, and then it will propagate to your systems policy hopefully soon, and then the issue will be fixed and you will still be able to allow the existing classifications rather than messing with the policy and modifying, working around it by substituting the attribute by your type and leaving out particular rules. Alrighty, so that's one thing I want to set straight. So yes, you please question any policy that is in the existing policy configuration. Don't just take anything for granted. See if there's any rules with the UBAC constraint type. I don't think, because this is a constraint rule and those can't be listed with SE search, so probably won't return anything, or at least not much constraint type. No, so that's basically a problem. So SE search and SE info can be used to query the existing policy configuration when it comes to type enforcement and role-based access control, but it cannot do so for policy constraints which are used for example, user-based access control for multi-level security and multi-category security existing policy models. So that's an issue that you need to be aware of. And so basically, if you're not sure and you want to be careful, then just don't add any classifications that do not return anything when you query them using SE search or something like that. So that was one issue I wanted to take care of. Another issue, I made an assumption in my previous video about the port type classification. So we basically if you remember, we substituted a rule with this rule in our previous video. It was, the previous rule was that we allowed dependency underscore t to bind TCP sockets to any unreserved port. And first of all, how would you know, if you're not familiar with the policy, what an unreserved port is and what it allows? So that's one thing. And then I assumed that if we create a private type for a port, it should be classified with the port type, which is basically wrong. So we need to fix that. We need to reassert that and redo that. So basically, how do you know the rules related to the unreserved port type? So as we search, and port types are basically objects, and objects don't interact, so you can basically assume that it's a target, unreserved port type, and then grep for unreserved port type, because this going to, if you don't, this will probably return a shitload of rules. Grep unreserved port type, and since we know it's a target, we can basically do that to narrow it down even more. So here are all the rules where the target is a where the target is classified with a unreserved port type classification. So basically, if you allowed dependency underscore t to bind TCP sockets to unreserved to port types with the it was unreserved port t. Sorry, it wasn't classified with the unreserved port type attribute. It was a rule that allowed dependency underscore t to name to bind TCP sockets to ports with types unreserved port t. Then basically other services would be, and I can narrow that down because it was related to TCP sockets. Then other services, like the services here or the domains here, would be allowed to bind sockets to the same port, so you could get conflict there where, for example, FTPD, the FTPD service would bind TCP sockets to a port that you were using, for example, your ZNC bouncer. So you don't want that, and that's why basically also why I decided to create a private port type for ZNC. And then I assumed that by classifying it a port type, it would be already in right. So that was a wrong assumption. So basically what we need to do is, we could, for example, use SELinux port, and then list all ports, and then basically pipe that to less. And then basically look for a port, an unreserved port. So unreserved ports are ports over 1024. So for example, this port ABC UPSD should be classified an unreserved port type because it's over 1024. So let's see if that's true. So let's use the edit info command xt and then paste the type in and see if it's classified the unreserved port type attribute. And it is classified in the reserved port type attribute. So we can use this example to classify our 7c underscore port underscore t type properly, because this is how basically unreserved port types should be classified, port types and unreserved port types, because our 31337 port is a port over 1024, and thus it should be classified an unreserved port type, because the same applies to the APC UPSD port type. So basically what we need to do is we need to edit our config, because we only classified it a port type, and that was not wrong, but it was not complete, because and that could break in the future our policy, and we don't want that. So we need to classify that properly. Then we see dependency port T, and then classify that an unreserved port type. This port is a port over 1024, and a defined port type. So basically, this port type is a private port type, I guess. But if you want to figure that all that stuff out, then use the ASCII info command and the ASCII search command to just figure out the properties of these classifications and figure out the properties of types and stuff like that. You need to be creative when it comes to ASCII info and ASCII search, so you can basically figure out all the stuff that applies to these classifications and these types, and just use that thoroughly, and then you won't, to at least to a large extent, won't be required to have a look at the source policy to understand your existing policy configuration where you're designing your policy module in. So we need to add some attributes to our required section, because we are requiring some other port type, and it's defined port type, I guess. Defined port type, is that right? Defined port type. Defined port type. So consistent naming is important. Also, there's other stuff that I didn't mention, that for example, when you name your types, that you name them consistently, so that you basically know what kind of type you're dealing with by just reading the type. So for example, the 7c underscore exact t, that you know, oh, that's an executable file, just because you have the underscore exact underscore in it. And same for your home files and for your domain type. But of course, you can never assume that the existing policy configuration also honors those style rules, because I would call them style rules, and that they also use these consistent names to basically do that. That's another issue. But by just investigating the policy and by just using ASCII info as such, you can get get far, and hopefully people at least use consistent names for their types, so that at least, and also for their type attributes, because you can basically assign our own type attributes, and we might do that later. And if you use a proper name, then you can just get a lot of info by just reading the attribute name. And if people use this consistently and use proper style rules, then that makes policy writing a lot easier. Okay, so another issue, because now we have classified our port type properly, so that's great. Another issue is dependency issues. Now, I thought about that, and I didn't know how to do this in raw policy, but I looked it up a little bit, and I think I know how to deal with it. So basically, our this policy module depends on, for example, all these type external type attributes, but it also depends on for example the unconfined role and the unconfined type. Now some of these attributes are basically declared, and some of these types and roles are declared in modules that are optional, that are basically, you can basically uninstall them when you list them using SE module -l, and it lists a lot of modules that you can basically disable or uninstall. Now if you would disable any module that has any of these classifications, for example declared in them, then basically the stuff would fail because this module depends on it. It's basically using it here. So for example, one of the, now I'll just have a look at it. Sudo SE module list and then less that. So for example, see if the user domain is optional. Yep, the user domain is optional. Now it doesn't make sense to basically disable this module, but in theory we could basically uninstall this module. And this module, and that's also something that's very hard to figure out, this module has, but you'll eventually know that something is wrong when stuff just doesn't uninstall. That module has that user home type declared, that user home type attribute declared. So basically, if you decide to deinstall the user domain module, it won't do that because it depends on this module, because this module is using that user home type attribute, so it won't be able to install unless you install this module as well. Now you can basically deal with that by using the optional block. Then it's the same kind of block as the require block. So for example, let's see if this actually works at all. So I'll just do one example and then basically clean it up later. The user home type is here required, so I'll remove that from there and then just make this optional, and then under there I'll require the attribute user home type, and then this rule should be optional. Now hopefully this builds and makes. Same goes for this one. The unconfined role is borrowed from the unconfined domain, which you can uninstall, and it actually makes sense to uninstall it. But you want to be able to uninstall it, so what you need to do is make that optional. Require role unconfined R, unconfined R, and basically I'm doing this wrong as well. It's unfortunate that it used the brackets in the same way as brace expansion. And then close the optional block. So that makes the unconfined role optional, so that it doesn't depend on it strictly. Of course, our module will stop working for unconfined role if the unconfined module isn't installed and we don't have other, we don't allow any other rules to the 7C domain. But still, at least you'll be able to uninstall the unconfined modules, and the same goes for these rules here. So these have the unconfined type, and these are declared in the unconfined module, and we want to be able to deinstall the unconfined module without blowing up. So that's basically here we have the optional, and then we have the optional, and then we have the require, and then we require type unconfined t in this optional block, unconfined t, and then we use these rules, and hopefully that this works. Use these rules in an optional block, and so these are just some examples. You will have to apply this stuff to all the rules where the target types are external. So for example, this also applies to the user home. This one also applies to the user domain module, so you should make that optional as well. So all the rules where the target is optional, the target type is optional, saying basically meaning that the module where the target type is declared is uninstallable, or you should make them optional. So I'll do that and first see if this builds. It's important if it installs, because if it doesn't, so let's see if I can find the old that part builds. That's a property of the modularized policy, so that you you'll be able to insert and remove optional modules without the stuff blowing up due to dependency issues, because you are depending on external you might be depending on external types and external classifications, and you want your system to not blow up if possible. It's installing still. So this chapter, it installed, so it actually worked. So this chapter was basically a correction to the first video where I made some mistakes. So I basically tried to correct myself, and also we dealt with the concept of optional policy, and we need to basically make the other external types and external attributes which are optional, we should make them optional before we proceed, but I'll finish that in another chapter, and for now we'll leave it at this.